There is another way. There is a competitor, and that's Glove. The first one was Word to Wake. The competitor is Glove. The idea behind Glove is very simple, and you're going to see it. It's extremely simple. You're going to do mean squared error, as simple as that. But then it is really powerful. And let's go through it. The idea is that you want to combine global matrix factorization methods and local context window methods. So what we just saw with continuous bag of words with a skip gram, they are local context window methods. So you give it a local context, and then it's going to do its operations on it. And then you can have a global matrix factorization. What is that? You're going to create a matrix of words that are appearing in each other's context. So the rows are going to be words, the columns of your matrix are going to be words, and then you're just going to count the number of times that these two words are appearing next to each other in your corpus. And that's going to give you a global matrix. And this is exactly what I just explained. You create X, it's a matrix of word co-occurrence counts. How many times did Glove co-occurred with Global in your corpus? How many times Global co-occurred with Glove, etc. And you're going to keep counting. So it's a statistical method. You're just counting. It's nothing complicated. And then you're going to create X. So Xij is the number of times that word J is occurring in the context of word I. We're going to take a log of Xij, and we are going to parameterize that. So log of Xij, we are going to parameterize it. We are going to say this is an assumption that you're making for your model. And then this assumption is going to make sense as I go more into details. So you have a vector, wi, for the input vector. You can have wj for the output vector. You multiply them together. That's going to give you a single number. And then you add two other numbers to it, bi and bj. So by global, there is a question with what does factorization mean? Factorization means what we are exactly doing here. So you're factorizing it in terms of vectors. That's what factorization means. And global means that you're computing your global statistics and putting it in a matrix. And by co-occurrence, we mean it has to be in the context. So it's going to look again in a window. For instance, global is in the context of Glove, vector could be in the context of Glove, and then maybe from this point on, they are not in the context. So you're going to choose a number. It's similar to what we saw. So does the matrix value depend on the context length? Exactly. Yes, it depends on the context length. And the question is, with a skip gram, a word has the same vector always. With continuous bag of words, the word vector changes. No, that's not correct. For both of them, each word, for both skip gram and continuous bag of words, the word vector, you're going to have one word vector per each word. Okay. Now we're going to represent log of xij with the vector, with the dot product of two vectors. And then we are going to add two biases. And exactly wi's are going to be our word vectors. So these are going to be our word vectors. And wj tilde is the context word vector. So we are just naming these. This is our word vector. This is our context word vector. Now what you're going to do, the loss function that you're going to write for Glove is very simple. You want this identity to hold. So you say wi transpose w tilde j plus bi plus b tilde j minus log of xij. So this term, the right-hand side minus the left-hand side, squared, they have to be close. So you want to minimize the penalty, the difference between these two. And then at the same time, you are putting some weight. So it's going to be a weighted regression. You are putting some weights on the importance of every two words. And I'm going to tell you why you're doing this and what type of F you're going to choose. But then you're going to do a summation over all of the words in your vector. So you're going to have two for loops for I and J. And they're going to go from 1 to capital V. And capital V is the size of your vocabulary. And this is a weighted least square. This is the weight that you're going to choose. Do you remember in skip gram model, we had to take care of the more frequent words in our dictionary and downweight them? Because usually when you do the histogram of your words, they're going to have a fat tail So there are some very important words that are not that much frequent. And if you don't do this weighting, you're never going to see those words in your algorithm. You're going to rarely see them during training. And then you're not going to, your method is not going to be able to associate meaning to those words. So yeah, that's a problem. It's a power law distribution that the words in your vocabulary are going to follow. They're going to be fat-tailed. And this is the type of weight that you're going to use. How does it look like? If two words appear in each other's context a lot, you're going to ignore that. So you're going to cap it. Because if it is very frequent, you already learned it. You saw it a lot of times during your training. So you're downweighting that. And there is going to be an X max, and the maximum is a hyperparameter that you choose. And this is basically your weighting function that you're going to use. And you're associating more weight. It's better than the linear relationship here. You're associating more weights to your less frequent words. And this alpha, surprisingly, turns out to be the same number that we chose here as well. It's surprising that this is happening, but both of the methods are using the same number, and that's giving them the best word vectors.
Is that power of 3/4 theoretically inspired, or just through experimentation?
Through experimentation, trial and error. So a lot of deep learning is trial and error, okay?
Yeah.
And then even this 100 is trial and error. And they're going to use it using their validation data. They look at the performance of their word vectors under validation, and then they're going to choose these two numbers. No, there is no theory behind it. How does it relate to EscapeGram? That's a great question to answer. How does it relate to EscapeGram model? For the EscapeGram model, we had this Qij, which was the softmax, the exponential of Wi transpose, Wj tilde, and then you had the softmax on that. So this you remember, that's the way that you modeled your probability. So now, for now, let's call it Qij. Now, the objective function for EscapeGram was that you wanted to maximize the log of these probabilities. And this also you remember, this is the first line of the loss function that I wrote down. Now you're just replacing that with Qij. I is in your corpus, it's a word in your corpus, and J is going to change in the context. And this minus sign is because in machine learning, we like to minimize. So it's exactly the same objective function. Now we are going to go ahead and group things together, because if you look here in this loss function here, we had a summation over I and J. And now we want to have a similar formulation to our loss function. We are going to say, if we group things together, we can start using this global matrix of word-word co-occurrence counts. This log of Qij is the same as above. This is all of the words. Now we are just grouping together the number of times that two words that are appearing in the same context, it's going to increase this value. It's number one. It would be 2, 3, 4, 5, up until 100 or even further up. It's exactly the same loss, but now you're using this global matrix. It's a matrix of counting word co-occurrences. Rather than doing summation over your corpus and the context, you can do this. It's just a reformulation of your loss. And Xi, if you do a summation over K, is the number of times that any word occurs in the context of I. What we are going to do, we are going to create Pij, which is Xij divided by Xi. So now it's the relative importance. And you can call this the probability that word J is occurring in the context of word I. So now you're turning your counts into probabilities. Now let's rewrite this loss function again. We are going to take Xi out. This Pij has Xi in it. So if you have Xi times Xi, it's going to give you Xij. Basically, Xi times Pij is going to give you Xij. So it's exactly this formula above. But now the cool thing is that you can take Xi out and represent this with your probabilities. Now this term here is the definition of cross entropy. So you have two distributions, Pi and Qi, and you're computing the cross entropy between them. And the cross entropy, you can think of it as a way of measuring the distance between two distributions. So now you're measuring the distance between Q and P. And then this Xi here is just the weight that you're using. So now you're starting to see the similarity. There is a weighting here there is a weighting here. This is weighted cross entropy. This is weighted least squares. And there is nothing special about cross entropy. We can replace that with mean squared error. So that's the idea. That's how they are similar. They are not equivalent, but they are similar. Rather than using the mean squared error as your distance, you're using the cross entropy. Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question. I'm trying to understand the intuition behind using subtracting the log of x in j. So I get that wi times wj will give you, since it's a dot product, a higher value will give you how similar the worlds are. And I get that you add the b's, but what's the intuition behind subtracting a log of some frequency value?
Can you point me to your question? Is it here?
Yeah, so it's on the left. Yeah, so j?
Yeah, so here. Yes.
A little lower. J equals the sum. Yeah, right here. So what's the intuition behind subtracting log of xij?
Oh, so we are going to make an assumption. We are going to represent log of xij by wi transpose wj, and these are the parameters of our model, okay? Now, if this is your assumption, if this is your model, then the intuition for this is clear because you are taking this term, subtracting from it the log of xij, and then you want these to be as close as possible to each other. It's not going to become equality, but they're going to become very close. So that's the intuition. The intuition is coming from the assumption that you're making. See, these are the same terms, wi transpose wj, it's here, bi is here, bj is here, and then minus log of xij is here.
Okay, so we just assume that the log of xij, which is the log of how many times a word appeared with another word, is how similar they are.
Yes, and the cool thing is that these numbers are from negative infinity to positive infinity, and the log is gonna turn counts, which are positive numbers, to have values from negative infinity to positive infinity, okay?
Is there go ahead.
Or equivalently, you could have said xij is equal to exponential of this, because you want your counts to be positive. Your counts cannot be negative. And that's the intuition behind log. Okay, what's the question?
I was gonna ask if there is an intuition behind this assumption, like this form with these like two biases and these two W vectors.
It turns out that you could have gotten away without these biases, but their existence is giving you your model more flexibility. These are just more parameters that are helping your model.
So you could just add on more and more parameters, which would like theoretically give your model more?
Not really. Usually in neural networks, in linear regression, forget about neural networks. Even for linear regression, you have the weight times your input plus a bias. And that bias is sort of acting as the mean of these log values. So you're sort of subtracting the mean.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? And this is a symmetric relationship. If you look at it from the I perspective, you have wi, bi. And if you look at it from the j perspective, you have b tilde j and w tilde j. So it's a symmetric representation. And your matrices are symmetric. The number of times that this guy is appearing in global context is equivalent to the number of times that Glov is appearing in global or global in Glov. So this bj tilde is for you to be symmetric. And then the bias is to take care of the mean of your distribution. Any other questions?
Is there a reason why we're trying to we're trying to estimate the log of xij with this this linear model? Is there a reason we're trying to do that instead of just xi without the logarithm?
Well, yes, this is exactly what I just said. If you do xij without the log, then the value on the left is always positive. It's a count. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 0. It's always positive. But the value on the right is going to become negative and sometimes positive. So whenever you want to turn a value that goes from negative infinity to positive infinity to be positive, you take an exponential. Yeah. It's a trick in deep learning. You're going to use it a lot.
Got it. Makes sense.
Any other questions?
So the only reason we use log is to fix the right side to be positive.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And let's see the performance for semantic and syntactic and total and compare them to continuous bag of words and skip gram. And these are the performance. For semantic, Glove is doing the best. For syntactic, still continuous bag of words is the best. And total, Glove is doing the best. So there seems to be a trade-off between these algorithms. It's not like one is better than the other. Maybe for some of your downstream tasks, having a good meaning in your words is very important to you. So you're going to use Glove or Skipgram. Or maybe it's very important for your algorithm to be able to get the syntax is correct. Maybe one application is auto-correction when you're typing emails or in Word, okay? For those types of applications, maybe syntax is more important than semantic. So usually a good paper is going to study the details of the algorithm. So they're going to change one thing, two things, three things, and then try to study what happens if I change that, what happens if I don't do that. So these are called ablation studies. So a good paper should do that all the time. And this is a good paper. One question is, what vector dimension should I use? What should be the dimension D of my vectors? You can keep studying it. Dimension 1 up until 100, 200, 300, etc. And then the performance is going to plateau at some point overall, the red one. And then the semantic is always better than syntactic as you increase the dimension. And the accuracy is going up and up. And at some point, you're going to saturate. So there is no point increasing your dimension perhaps beyond 600. For symmetric context, you can have either symmetric context or asymmetric context. For symmetric context, you're looking at the words to the left and to the right. And for asymmetric, you're always looking at the words to the right, for instance. Those are your contexts. And now we are studying the window size. So as you change your window size, you are getting better at semantic compared to syntactic. And for asymmetric context, it's the same pattern, but then you're pushing it to the right a little bit. How does the training time compare to continuous bag of words and Skipgram? Here you're comparing Glove to continuous bag of words. And then the training time is in terms of hours. The more you let your Glove model to train, the better accuracy you're going to get. Similarly for versus Skipgram. The more you let it train, the better it's getting. This figure is saying that if you train it for 6 hours, then the word vectors that you're getting out of Glove is better than continuous bag of words. I think we are over time. For those of you who want to leave, you can leave. And for those of you who want to stay and ask more questions, I'll be around.
I had a question in regards to the relationship to Skipgram. So I'm just trying to understand the concept. So Q is it a softmax? Softmax?
Yes. So this is softmax.
And then J is basically the loss function that we're trying to reduce.
Yes, J is your loss function.
And then what do we do from then?
From here onwards,
yeah.
From this line to this line, rather than doing your summation over your corpus and your context, you're going to group things together. Wherever you're doing multiple computations, you're going to group them together because it's going to be the same value, but then you're doing it multiple times. And then you can group them together by this count matrix. If you're repeating this log of Qij and then you're summing over it multiple times, you can compute it only once and then multiply it by the number of times that you did that operation.
That makes sense. And then what do we do?
And then you turn these Xijs to probabilities because in the end, we wanted to come up with the cross entropy between Qs because Qs are probabilities, Xijs are not. We can turn them into probabilities by dividing by the total number of times that any word is appearing in the context.
Okay, and that shows us how similar Skipgram is to Glove?
Yes. So it shows us that even for Glove, you have a weight. But then this weight, we were choosing it smartly. If you remember, we were getting rid of some of our words on the fly. So this is not a linear weighting. Even for Glove, it's gonna, even for continuous bag of words and Skipgram, your weighting is gonna look something like this in practice. But now this is your weight mathematically. That's your weight. So there's an analogy there. This is a distance measure. This is another distance measure. Rather than using cross entropy, you could use that.
Okay, I think I get it.
Okay, perfect. Any other questions?
I had a quick question. So in this method, instead of like looking at either the context only or like a single word only, we're sort of doing both simultaneously. Is that correct?
Yes, so that's correct. So you're going to create a matrix that is summarizing your entire data set. You don't go word by word. You create a matrix, and then you just do a count. How many times in my entire corpus the word vector appeared in the context of global? This is X, this is your word I, this is word J, and then you just count it. This is one time, then maybe in another sentence they are appearing in the same context, then you keep counting.
And then in a mini batch here would just be like a fraction of V of your total vocabulary.
So yeah, for mini batching, you're going to sample from this matrix X.
Okay.
So you're going to sample a bunch of input words, a bunch of output words, and then you just sum over them and try to minimize them. So yes, you can do mini batching on this.
Okay.
What is D again? It's the word vector, but for some reason I thought that the word vector is relating to how many vocabulary words you have.
You mean this dimension, yes, D?
Yeah, I was thinking about that as the one hot factor. So if you have 100 words, you're going to have 100 dimensions for some reason.
This is actually the projection.
Oh, okay, so it's a projection. So that's the lower dimensionality after the one hot vector?
Yes, so this is the lower dimension.
Okay, that makes sense.
And this can take values in its entries. It doesn't have to be either a 0 or a 1. It could be any number from negative infinity to infinity.
Yeah, that makes sense because it's just a lower dimensionality vector of the one hot encoding.
Yes. And these are the parameters of your model, wi, wj, b, I, bj.
Okay, cool. Thanks a lot.
Yes. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Sure.
In the graph of accuracy versus training time, the x-axis shows iterations of the glove model.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering what part of the model is actually changing over each iteration.
Over each iteration, the model doesn't change, but these parameters get updated.
Okay.
So the more you let it train, it's getting better.
I see. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.